Today, let us discuss one of the important topic in biochemistry, that is jaundice, which is an infection of liver. Now, before discussing about this jaundice, let us discuss some terminology of jaundice. That is, first one, hyperbilirubinemia. First one is hyperbilirubinemia. Next one is jaundice. And next one is icterus. And next one is cholestasis. Let us discuss these four terminologies before discussing briefly about jaundice. First, let us discuss about hyperbilirubinemia. Before discussing about hyperbilirubinemia, the normal range of bilirubin in our body is 0.2 to 1.2 grams per deciliter. This is the normal range of bilirubin. But whenever, if the bilirubin concentration in our blood is more than 1.2, it is not considered as bilirubinemia. But whenever it is more than 2.5 grams per deciliter, it is considered as hyperbilirubinemia. When the concentration of bilirubin is more than 2.5, then it is considered as hyperbilirubinemia. Now, what is jaundice means? Yellow discoloration of underlying tissues and skin and eyes because of hyperbilirubinemia is called jaundice. Yellow discoloration of skin, underlying mucous layers and eyes because of hyperbilirubinemia is called jaundice. This is about hyperbilirubinemia and this is about jaundice. And what is icterus? The term icterus is yellow discoloration of sclera because of hyperbilirubinemia. Once again, yellow discoloration of scleral because of hyperbilirubinemia condition is called jaundice, and this is about, is called icterus. Now, this is about jaundice and icterus. What is cholestasis? Cholestasis, as we know that our bile consists of many structures in it, but the three important structures of bile is bile acids and bile pigments and other one is cholesterol. These are the three important parts of bile, that is bile acids, bile pigment and cholesterol. It is about, now what is cholestasis means? Along with bile, some bile acids and bile pigments and cholesterol will be drained into the blood. It will be drained into the blood, and the concentration of bile acids, bile pigment and cholesterol in the blood will be increased. This condition is called cholestasis. These are some important introduction of jaundice. And first let us discuss hyperbilirubinemia condition. Before discussing about hyperbilirubinemia, how this bile or how this bilirubin is formed, let us discuss how this bilirubin is formed. Let us consider, this is the spleen. This is the spleen and this is one of the macrophage. This is spleen and this is one of the macrophage. And inside of this macrophage, it consists of one RBC. Let us consider this is the RBC. This is one of the RBC in macrophage. Now, whenever this RBC will be ruptured, it produces three components. First one, hemoglobin. First one is hemoglobin. Second one is proteins. Proteins. And third one is membranous part. Membranous part, proteins, and hemoglobin. These are the three components of RBC when it is ruptured. Now, this membranous part, when it gets dissolved, it forms two structures. One is lipids and other one is proteins. Now, these proteins will form amino acids. These lipids will form fatty acids. This is the digestion of membranous part and remaining one is proteins. These proteins will undergo digestion process and will result in formation of amino acids. There is a complete description of proteins and membranous part, and the leftover part is hemoglobin. As we know that the hemoglobin consists of four tetramers. Example, this is one pyrrole ring. Two alpha chains and two beta chains. This is the structure of hemoglobin. Whenever it is ruptured, now this is a heme molecule and this is a globin chain, and this globin chain will get detached from this and will be digested and results in formation of amino acids. And the leftover part is iron molecule. One is heme and other one is iron molecule. Now, how this iron molecule, let us discuss the catabolism of this iron molecule. The iron molecule which is produced will be in toxic form, but this iron molecule has to convert in non-toxic form. Now, this is the iron molecule. Now, to convert this iron molecule into non-toxic form, there is a special protein that is called apoferritin. Now, this apoferritin will get binded to the iron molecule. It results in formation of special structure, that is ferritin. This is called ferritin. Whenever this ferritin is formed, it is combination of apoprotein and iron molecule. This ferritin has capacity to attract some more ferritin molecules towards it, and it results in formation of a special structure, that is there is some clusters of ferritin molecules. Inside it consists of iron molecules. Now, this special component is called hemosiderin. This which is called hemosiderin, and this is a action of iron molecule, and the leftover molecule is four structured protoporphyrin. Now this protoporphyrin, which is formed, will get converted into bilirubin. This bilirubin will get converted into bilirubin. This is bilirubin. Now, the bilirubin which is formed will be transferred into the vascular system. Let us consider this is the cardiovascular system, and this bilirubin which is formed will be moved inner side of this cardiovascular system. It will be situated in the inner side of this cardiovascular system. Now this is one part, and here there is a liver. Inside of the liver there is hepatocytes. These are the hepatocytes, and this is a pathway which is coming outer side from the liver. Now as you know that these are the hepatocytes. These hepatocytes have two phases, which is facing towards the, in which one phase is facing towards the cardiovascular system, and other phase is facing towards the canaliculate. There is a special structure in the liver that is these are called intrahepatic biliary canaliculi. Intrahepatic biliary canaliculi. Now, one phase of hepatocytes is facing towards the biliary canaliculi, and other phase is facing towards the cardiovascular system. Now, whenever this bilirubin is entered into the cardiovascular system, these hepatocytes will release special protein into the cardiovascular system, which will act on this bilirubin. It will be acted upon the bilirubin. Now, this entire structure is called unconjugated bilirubin. When it is present in the cardiovascular system, it is in unconjugated bilirubin. Whenever this special protein, which is called bilirubin binding protein, that is called bilirubin binding protein, which is binded to the bilirubin, this entire structure is called unconjugated bilirubin. Now this unconjugated bilirubin will again enter back into the hepatocytes. Now whenever it is entering into the hepatocytes, there is a special enzyme which is present in the hepatocyte, that is glucuronyl transferase. This special enzyme is called glucuronyl transferase. Now this unconjugated bilirubin will be entered into the hepatocytes. This is called, now this glucuronyl transferase 1 and glucuronyl transferase 2, with the help, with the action of these two enzymes, this unconjugated bilirubin will be converted into the conjugated bilirubin. That is, this is the conjugated bilirubin. Now this conjugated bilirubin, which is formed, has to travel from inner side of this liver to the external side of liver through the intrahepatic biliary canaliculi. It will reach, it will come out from either left hepatic duct or right hepatic duct. This is right hepatic duct. Now this unit together to form common hepatic duct. Now it will fuses with the cystic duct of gallbladder and forms common bile duct. It forms common bile duct, and there is a one more duct, that is pancreatic duct. This is a pancreatic duct. Now this common bile duct and pancreatic duct will result to form hepatopancreatic duct. Will form hepatopancreatic duct. Now the conjugated bilirubin has to travel in this way. When it is traveling in this pathway, whenever it reaches to the gastrointestinal tract, that is intestine, this conjugated bilirubin will get converted into uroporphyrinogen. And later it get converted into stercobilin. In this way the bilirubin will be formed. This is a formation of bilirubin. And what are the conditions which results in hyperbilirubinemia means? First condition, that is, if there is more rupture of RBC, more rupture of RBC, it results in hyperbilirubinemia. And second condition is whenever hemolytic anemia occurs. Whenever the hemolytic anemia occurs, it results in hyperbilirubinemia. And third condition is absorption of hematoma. These are the three conditions which results in increase of hyperbilirubinemia, that is RBC, increase of hematic anemia, and third one is absorption of hematoma. These are the three conditions which results in increase of hyperbilirubinemia. Now this is a condition of liver. With regarding this liver, there is one more disorder, that is jaundice. Before discussing about this jaundice, and there, this is the first condition, and there is second condition, that is if there is any impairment in the glucuronyl transferase, it is converted into three categories. First one is low decrease of glucuronyl transferase, and second one is moderate decrease of glucuronyl transferase, and third one is severe decrease of glucuronyl transferase. These are the three conditions which results in hematoma. That is, whenever this glucuronyl transferase is dissolved, it results in hyperbilirubinemia. And if there is moderate decrease of glucuronyl transferase, This unconjugated bilirubin cannot get converted into conjugated bilirubin, which results in hyperbilirubinemia. And last one is severe decrease of glucuronyl transferase. These are the three conditions. These are the second conditions. And these are the first conditions which results in hyperbilirubinemia. And this is some information about hyperbilirubinemia. And there is one more disorder which is associated with this glucuronyl transferase decrease. And there is a special disorder that is called Grigler-Najjar syndrome. Grigler-Najjar syndrome, which is caused because of deficiency of glucuronyl transferase, and it is converted into, and these are of two types, type 1 and type 2. Type 1 is because of severe decrease of glucuronyl transferase, severe decrease of glucuronyl transferase, and type 2 is because of moderate decrease of glucuronyl transferase, moderate decrease of glucuronyl transferase. Compared to these two, first, type 1 of Grigler-Najjar syndrome is very harmful. In case of newly born babies, the newly born baby will be die within 1 week of their delivery. This is one syndrome of glucuronyl transferase. And there is one more disease which is associated with liver, that is hepatitis. Let us consider this is the hepatocyte, and there is one more disease which is associated with liver is hepatitis. The normal definition of hepatitis is inflammation of the liver, which is characterized by splitting of inflammatory cells into the biliary canaliculi. It's called hepatitis. This hepatitis will be of two types. One is infectious form and non-infectious form. One is infectious, other one is non-infectious. If we discuss about infectious form, it is because of viral and bacterial and fungal and protozoal. The virus which is responsible for infectious hepatitis is hepatotrophic virus and non-hepatotrophic virus. Hepatotrophic virus and non-hepatotrophic virus. Example for hepatotrophic virus is hepatitis A, hepatitis B, and C, and Delta. And example for non-hepatotrophic virus is yellow fever. This is some information of bacterial, viral, and the bacteria which is responsible for hepatitis is, infectious hepatitis is, spirochetes. And coming to the non-infectious form, first one is alcohol, and second one is drugs, and third one is toxins. These are the conditions which results in hepatitis, that is infectious and non-infectious. And let us discuss jaundice with correlative of these syndromes. Jaundice is yellow discoloration of connective tissues or inner connective tissues and skin and eyes because of hyperbilirubinemia is called jaundice. First condition which results in jaundice is increase of RBC. If there is increase in RBC rupture, then more amount of bilirubin will be formed. As a result, bilirubin concentration will be increased in your body. And second one is if there is hemolytic anemia, then there is more hemolysis and more bilirubin will be formed and increases in bilirubin concentration, ultimately causes hyperbilirubinemia and causes jaundice. And next, last one is absorption of hematoma. If there is more absorption of hematoma, then more amount of bilirubin will be formed and results in hyperbilirubinemia and results in jaundice. And this is the first condition. And the second condition is if there is low decrease or moderate decrease or slight decrease or severe decrease of glucuronyl transferase, the amount of unconjugated bilirubin inside the body will be increased and it ultimately results in unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia. and causes jaundice, and this is second condition. And third condition is if there is any obstruction in the intrahepatic biliary canaliculi. Intrahepatic biliary canaliculi. Now, the conjugated form of bilirubin which is formed has to travel in this pathway. But if there is any blockage in this intrahepatic biliary canaliculi, now there will be blockage of this bilirubin in this hepatocytes. As a result, the conjugated bilirubin will be increased. This is third condition. As a result, conjugated hyperbilirubinemia condition will be erased, and ultimately it results in jaundice. And fourth condition, fourth cause is if there is any blockage in this, if there is any blockage in external side of liver, that is fourth cause. If there is external side blockage in this pathway, now the conjugated bilirubin which is formed will be entered outer side of this liver, that is through the intrahepatic biliary canaliculi, and it will be stuck in this area. Then the conjugated bilirubin concentration will be increased and results in conjugated hyperbilirubinemia, and it results in jaundice. This is the fourth condition. And fifth condition is if there is any formation of gallstones. If there is any formation in the gallstones, like gallstones in the gallbladder, then it results in blockage of this gallstone which is formed will be entered into the pathway. Now there will be blockage. As a result, the conjugated bilirubin will be stuck in this area, and there is no passage of this conjugated bilirubin, which results in conjugated hyperbilirubinemia, which is fifth condition. Fifth cause which results in hyperbilirubinemia ultimately causes jaundice. And next one is if there is any abnormality or impairment in the liver which is coming from pancreatic duct, it will enter into the pathway. Now the conjugated bilirubin which is formed will be stuck in this area. In this way, the bilirubin will be accumulated. It results in conjugated bilirubin hyperbilirubinemia. Hyperbilirubinemia will be of two types. One is hyperbilirubinemia will be of two types. One is conjugated hyperbilirubinemia, and next one is non-conjugated hyperbilirubinemia. One is conjugated and other one is non-conjugated hyperbilirubinemia. This is about jaundice. Now a doctor who is treating this jaundice patient has to consider three criteria. First one is the history of patient who is suffering from jaundice has to consider, and second one is physical state of this person who is suffering from jaundice has to consider, and last one is lab reports. This is complete picture of jaundice, and this is the cardiovascular system in which the blood is flowing. And this is complete picture of jaundice.